Boindil strikes up song during your hike. A short while later, Bavrigor joins in. But rather than actually singing along, he tries to outdo Boindil with his own songs. When he finally strikes up a love song, Boindil becomes absolutely livid. You take the stonemason to one side and ask him if he's doing it on purpose.
Of course I'm doing it on purpose. I'm gonna make him suffer the whole journey.
Can't go on like this. We can't fight amongst ourselves and save Girdlegard.
You take a short break before you dare breach the roots of the problem.
It's to do with a woman, right?
Not in the way you might think. Smeralda was my sister, a young thing of only 40 cycles.
Bavrigor takes a large swig of his liquor before he continues.
She was almost as belligerent as Boindil, and she got it into her blockhead to stand by him in battle. A bad decision.
You can see the pain he is suffering in his eyes. You place a hand on his shoulder and put him under no pressure to carry on. The constant bickering between Boindil and Bavrigor distracts you. Goimgar hears the clanking of armor first.
Something's coming!
Before you know it, the orcs are charging towards you over a hillside.
Is it something bad?
Huh?
What's up?
Huh?
What do you want me to do? And that'll be safe, will it?
Huh?
Is it something bad?
Of course.
Huh? Understood.
Huh? Yes, yes. I'm with you. Of course. Yes, yes.
And again. Yes?
Yes? Yeah! What do you want me to do?
Don't take it personally. What's up? He won't last long.
Understood.
And what now? Of course!
Disgusting.
Is it something bad?
Taste my hammer!
Attack!
What do you want me to do?
He hardly put up a fight! A bit too much for you, was I?
Huh?
Yeah? Of course!
Yes?
What is it? Let's go! Disgusting.
And what now?
Huh? On my way.
Don't take it personally.
Understood.
Yes? Yeah. And that'll be safe, will it?
Huh?
Yes, yes! Of course! I'm with you! Yes, yes!
Just
of course! Ha
ha! At once!
What is it?
End it!
What's up?
That'll be all right, then.
At once.
Of course! I'm with you! Yes, yes! What do you want me to do? And what now?
What's up? Why not?
And again.
Let's go.
He hardly put up a fight.
Why not?
And that'll be safe.
On my way.
Yes?
Why not?
Is it something bad?
Understood.
What is it?
Of course! I'm with you!
Huzzah!
Yes, yes! Of course!
Who's next? Huzzah! Come here, you!
I'm with you! Yes, yes! I'm with you! Yes, yes! I'm with you! Yes, yes! Of course! Yes, yes! I'm with you! Of course! I'm with you! Yes, yes!
Yes?
Huzzah!
Huh?
Yes?
Yeah!
Maybe it's better there.
Yes?
And what now? Is it something bad?
Huh? At once.
What's up?
Huh?
I'm with you! Of course! Yes, yes! Of course! Yes, yes! Ha ha! Of course! Yes, yes! Of course! And what now? I'm with you! Come here, you! Of course!
Yes?
Hmm? Yeah, why not?
Yes?
Yeah! Yeah!
Ha! I got one! What do you want me to do? And that'll be safe, will it? Oh, all right then. And that'll be safe, will it? Hey! Oh, all right then. Maybe it's better there. And that'll be safe, will it? No, if you insist. Maybe it's better there. Yeah. And that'll be safe, will it? No, if you insist. Yeah. Oh, is that a good idea? Yeah. Him. Ooh, he's pretty big. Yeah. Oh, is that a good idea? Yeah. No, if you insist. And that'll be safe, will it? Oh, is that a good idea? Him. He's pretty big.
Huh?
I'm with you.
Yes?
Of course. That'll be safe, will it?
Prepare you.
Is that a good idea? Better there.
If you insist.
I'm with you. Huh?
Take my hammer.
Is that a good idea?
Yeah, why not?
He has.
Huh? And what now?
Disgusting.
Of course.
Who's next? He hardly put up a fight!
What do you want me to do?
Huh?
Yeah!
Yes?
A bit too much.
What is it?
Was I?
Yeah, I wasn't expecting that, were you?
He hardly put up a fight! Who's next?
Of course! Yes, yes!
What's up?
What do you want me to do?
Yes?
Of course!
Huh? Understood.
That'll be safe, will it?
Why not? Then.
And what now? Ha-ha! I'm with you!
Yeah?
That'll be safe, will it?
Understood.
Why not?
Come away, then. Is it just...
What is it?
Of course! Yes, yes! I'm with you!
Huh? At once.
That'll be safe, will it?
Come away,
then. And what now?
close up.
Huh? Huzzah!
Yeah? He won't last long.
Huh?
End it.
He has?
Who's next?
And again.
Yes?
And what now? Come here, you.
Ha ha! I got one.
Of course. I'm with you. Yes, yes.
Who's next?
Is it something
What's
bad?
Up? Yeah, we're not.
He is.
Huh?
At once.
Huh? I'm with you. Huzzah!
Huh?
Hmm?
Is it something bad?
Hey! Yeah!
Huh?
And what now?
Yeah?
He has? No.
Yeah!
If you insist.
What is it? He hardly put up a fight.
Is it something bad?
For Vrakus! End it. Please wait a moment.
Taste my hammer.
He has?
Huh? Yes?
Yeah! And what now?
What's up?
Is it something?
Don't take it personal,
vile creature.
What do you want me to do?
Ah, that was refreshing. Hey, here comes some more. 3, 4, 5, 5 or 6.
5 or 6? Oh, phew. He means 500.
Goimgar turns white as a sheet.
That's too many. To the city. Come on.
You flee towards Mifidania, with Goimgar out ahead. The orcs at his back seem to have mobilized unimagined powers in him, and he reaches the gate first, hammering manically against it. He says something and scurries through a small gateway that has been opened to him. Moments later, you also reach the gate.
Get in, quickly!
You push your way through the gate as the first orc arrows slam into the wood next to you.
The other dwarf said we should bolt the gate behind him, but we could use all the help we can get when the orcs come. That treacherous sissy, where is he?
Boendal and I will look for him. Boindiel and Bavrigor, help the city guards in any way you can.
You were certain the two of them wouldn't be much help in the search for Goimgar.
Look at all those runts. They are growing in number by the day, and still they don't dare to come closer. Ha! They know very well that they can't get over our walls.
The main gate is bolted shut and makes a sturdy impression. As long as there are men who know how to defend the gate, the orcs will not be able to get through it. The main gate.
There's a whole load of orcs out there. But the walls should hold out. They're quite solid. For human walls.
So, have you found the little coward? He must be somewhere in the city. He's too scared to leave it.
Weyern is well known for its love of the written word. Some of the scripts on offer are known to you from Lot Yonan's library. Weyern has many huge lakes and is rich in a variety of fish and seafood. As the mountains of the dwarves are far away from these large lakes, most of the fish are not part of their normal diet. You only know of obelisks from books, and you didn't expect to see one here. The inscription seems to you to be of southern origin. You see some good horses and ponies in the stables. You decide to find out about prices as soon as you have found Goimgar. After having seen the kingdom of the Secondlings, even this impressive human city is somehow rather disappointing. The only thing that attracts your attention are the oil lamps that line the street. Only a trading city could afford something like that. All of the gates are bolted shut. The city seems to be secure, at least for the moment. Locked gates also mean, of course, that you can't get out. In the past, travelling showmen regularly put up tents like this in front of Lot Yonan's vaults to draw a little money from the pockets of the servants and the famuli, with plays, vocal performances, and all kinds of fun.
I am glad that the children of Vrakus are here. What can I do for you, sir?
The man tries to give off an air of normality, but he occasionally glances nervously over to the city wall.
This is the biggest human city I've ever seen, after Parista.
You haven't chosen a very good time to take a look at Mifidania, sir, and I don't just mean because of the orcs outside our gates. The winter is only just now retreating into the mountains. In a couple of weeks, it will be spring, and the city will burst into bloom.
The man glances at the city wall once again.
At least, I hope it will.
Have you heard any news from other lands?
Nodon is rampaging through the land with his orcs and the Alpha. The Magi are all dead, and no one has heard any more of the host that moved against Porista. These are dark times, but I think it's important that we don't despair. We must trust in the gods. We have to.
You would have liked to have told the trader that, as well as trusting in the gods, he should also wish you and your companions luck. But that would have just led to more questions.
Farewell, and good luck. The fabulous Rodario.
cometh, dear spectators, cometh and see. Let the theater curiosum, with its star actor, the fabulous Rodario, the mysterious Nomora, and the genius Magister Technicus, Fergas, carry you off to another world. Now see and hear, dear spectators, the truth about Nudin the Knowledge Lusty, who disposed of the other Magi in a most horrifying way and plunged Girdlegard into disaster.
Girdlegard, it will be mine.
Lord Yone?
When you murdered Frala and the others...
To your horror, you realize that you can no longer talk. You feel a lump in your throat and your eyes begin to burn as images of the vaults and Syntharas appear in front of you.
I see that my first strike really hit you, Groundling. Oh, how they screamed. If only you had been there to help them.
What do you want with my rucksack? If you're looking for provisions, you could have just asked me nicely.
I'm not interested in what's in the rucksack. I only know that the Lord of the Perished Land wants it. So he will have it.
Your master doesn't tell you much by the sounds of it. Either he doesn't trust you, or he's in the habit of not talking about his business with servants.
You feel the blade cutting into your skin, and you take it as a sign of a small victory.
This way! What was that, an elf?
If we're quick, we'll get that long ear yet.
Alarm! Alarm! The orcs are attacking!
Come, we must defend the walls. Understood.
Yeah? Huh? As good as done.
Hmm? Of course.
Yes?
And what now?
Yes?
Yes, yes!
Uh-huh.
Yeah!
Pavrakus, what is it?
On my way! As good as done!
What's up?
Yes?
Too much for you, was I?
And what now?
Uh-huh.
What is it?
Yes? Yeah!
Oh, what bad luck for you! Say goodbye forever.
With pleasure.
He won't last long.
End it.
What is it?
What's up?
Pow!
Ow! Another one bites the dust!
Ugh, disgusting! Taste my hammer!
Huh? I'm with you! Yes, yes!
And what
say
now?
Say goodbye forever! And it's bad luck for you!
What is it?
All right.
Don't take it personally.
Very good. We're able to stop them.
Simple as. You wish it weren't so. But it is clear to you now that the city can no longer be saved.
To the side gate. It's our only chance.
Huh?
What's up?
And what
with
now?
With pleasure. Say
huzzah!
Goodbye forever.
I'm with you.
Yes? Understood.
Huh?
Yeah?
He won't last long.
He hardly put up a fight.
Disgusting. Taste my hammer!
Huh?
Attack!
What is it?
And what now?
Huh?
Yeah. He won't last. Taste my hammer,
creature!
Huh?
You? What is it? All right. Yeah!
What is it?
Huh? On my way.
Yeah. Huh? At once.
End it! Yeah!
Understood.
Too easy!
And what now?
What is it? All right! As good as better!
What's up?
Yes?
Yeah! End it! Yes? All right,
go!
Huh? Yeah! What is it? On my way!
Yes?
What is it?
Yes, yes!
Kill!
Of course!
Huh?
What's up?
Yeah, why not?
Huh?
For Vrakus!
Yeah!
At once.
Huh?
Yes, yes!
Ha-ha!
What is it?
Yeah?
He won't last long.
Attack!
Yes?
Ah!
And again!
Ugh, disgusting!
Yes?
What is it?
Don't take it personally!
Too easy!
What is it?
Yeah?
Huh?
End it!
Huh?
up.
Yes. Understood.
Yeah! I didn't hit you very hard! What is it? All right.
Don't take it personally.
What is it? Huzzah!
Wild creature.
Killed. At once.
Yeah? Let's go.
Disgusting. What is it?
Understood. At once.
I'm with you.
What am I doing?
What is it?
What's up? Of course. Let's go. Yeah, why not? Let's go.
And what now?
Yes, understood.
What is it? I'm with you.
Too much for you, was I?
I'm with you.
Vile creature.
What is it?
And again.
And what now? Yes, yes. I'm with you. Yes. Yes.
As good as done.
Vile creature.
On my way.
And again. As good as done. That
of course.
Was. Understood.
Yeah, why not?
On my way. Hey, Brackus.
Vile creature.
Retire yourself.
Yes.
Understood. Come away. Understood.
Yeah, why not?
Come away. Understood. It's locked. We have to open it somehow.
Perhaps we can be of service, gentlemen.
Step aside.
Are you thieves?
Certainly not. We are artists. People with extraordinary talents. Say, friends, as you clearly mean to leave Mifidania too, would you have anything against us joining you?
The fabulous Radaria.
Oh, an admirer of my skills? Who would have thought it? I am indeed the one and only fabulous Radario. This worthy gentleman here is Fergus, the best magister technicus since human thought. And last but not least, the enchanting Namora, whose beauty makes the mare's roses wither in envy. Perhaps we should discuss the rest when we are out of this mess.
We have a long and dangerous journey ahead of us. I don't think you really want to join us.
An epic and dangerous journey? That sounds like an adventure. And anyway, I have already seen that you know how to handle those weapons of yours. In these dangerous times, a big travel group offers the best protection, don't you think?
I don't know.
The orcs are still surging through the gate and over the wall. You decide that this isn't the right time for discussions.
All right then, let's go.
Let's get out of here. We'll be safe with the firstlings.
The firstlings, the splendor of their halls is said to be unrivaled, and I have heard they have fascinating contraptions, Fergus, that are almost reminiscent of magic.
It's open, let's go.
In the evening after your escape from Mifidania, you recover from your exertions around a campfire. Goimgar withdraws to a solitary corner. Bavrigor devotes himself to his alcohol, and the twins get their smelly dwarf cheese out. Nomura and Fergus exchange hugs and kisses on the other side of the fire, while Rodario sits next to you.
Ah, a journey with real dwarves to the stronghold of the Firstlings. I'm sure I can write that into my new piece.
I must congratulate you on your skills. Find it hard to believe that it's not achieved by magic.
Aha, thank you, but I assure you it has nothing to do with magic, just alchemy and accomplished acting. We leave the sorcery to the Magi.
Don't mention them. There's no love lost in Andokai and her walking iron tower.
You've met Andokai the Tempestuous? That is unbelievable. How was she?
She ran away to the Outer Lands. A damn disgrace.
Andokai had her reasons to leave us. She had already fought against Nodon and was unsuccessful. Furthermore, we wouldn't be here without her, and she told us about Keenfire.
Andokai, the bringer of hope. I like that. I'll have to use that in my new piece.
True to his words, Rodario takes out his notebook and writes something down.
We're far enough away from Mifidania. Perhaps we should part ways tomorrow morning.
Rodario jumps up and begins to gesticulate ostentatiously.
I think you have underestimated us. Let me introduce myself and my colleagues once more. I am the Fabulous.
We don't have time to look after a pack of jesters.
Rodario seems offended for a moment, but then he grins, turns away from the group, and raises his right arm. A jet of flame shoots out of his sleeve. The dwarves are startled and amazed by the brief spectacle.
And what do you say now, critical Mr. Dwarf?
You're a magus. I don't particularly like them either.
At the Curiosum, magic is my area of responsibility. There is a tube under his arm with a flint and a bag full of lycopediella seeds. When he firmly presses the bag, the flint sprays sparks and the seeds shoot out. And there you have it. Magic fire.
Masterly work, Fergus.
The Magister Technicus shows his appreciation with a nod of his head.
If they all have tricks like this up their sleeves, well, they might not be such a burden after all, Tungnil.
How are you doing for provisions? We don't have enough.
We are happy to share what we have. It isn't very much, though. We had to leave most of it behind.
Food is sure to be a problem on our journey. Winter's only just beginning to leave, Weyen, and people will be keeping a tight grip on the stocks they do have because of the orc attacks.
We have to be frugal and organize as much food as we can. It wouldn't be much of a heroic story if we starved on the way to the Firstlings.
Do you know anything about the Firstlings? If I recall the map correctly, we need to cross the first large mountains in the Red Range and then pass through Snowdale to East Ironhald's stronghold.
No one has seen the Firstlings for hundreds of cycles, but there are many stories about them. Their craftsmanship is much vaunted, and there used to be trade via a narrow path that led into the mountains. But I don't think there is a man living now who has ever walked that road.
Our mission is to forge the legendary axe Keenfire and destroy the traitor Nodon. If you wish to accompany us through hunger, coldness, and danger, then do so. It's your decision.
How could we not partake in such a story? Just think, what a wonderful play we could make of it.
If we survive. I was hoping to only resurface once we reach the Red Range. Instead, we have a long journey and a dangerous climb ahead of us.
There may be another way apart from the old trading route. A few years ago, an old man from the north told me of a place called Wackenstein. Apparently, there is an old path there, older than the dwarven tunnels themselves.
Legends and stories. There's too much uncertainty. Let's just see what the next few days bring.
You reach a large camp with dozens of humans, countless campfires, and several wagons in and around the camp. You notice traders and guardsmen with Mifidania's coat of arms, but also others that you don't know. You decide to take a look around the camp. All in all, the refugees are in bad shape, and you can't even see the slightest glimmer of hope in most of their eyes.
Ha! I know you, dwarf. You were in Mifidania. Ran off with your friends when things got tricky, eh? You're not such great orc killers, or you wouldn't have left Mifidania to its fate.
We are dwarves, not gods. We did our best. No one could have saved Mifidania.
The fatigue that had disappeared from the man's face for a moment returns.
I hated that city with its wretched stench of fish. It's just so many dead.
I can see some guardsmen from Mifidania here too. How did you escape?
The authorities ordered the guards to protect the city to the very last man, while they, the high society, made off unnoticed. When the guards and the townspeople saw them go, they dropped their weapons and ran. The quickest made it. Just a few dozen.
A few dozen. How many people could you have saved if you'd stayed? On the other hand, how many will die if you don't stop Nod On?
We're headed to the old dwarf stronghold on the Red Range. Do you know the way?
You're going to travel through Snowdale so soon after winter. Good luck. And what are you hoping to find? There aren't any dwarves left in the mountains, I'm telling you.
We'll see. What about the old trading route?
The trader shrugs his shoulders.
Head west. There is only one road that leads into the mountains. If you've got a death wish, then you're heading the right way.
You're heading south. I wish you luck.
You don't think these people have much of a chance of survival, and a last look at the trader's face reveals that he doesn't either. You spend the night protected from the wind in a ruin, and are sitting around a campfire as the topic of your new companion's performance on the stage comes up.
Sleight of hand, speed, alchemy, and makeup can have an incredible effect. Namora transformed herself into an elf using the latter.
I also noticed your weapons, Namora. I've never seen such swords before.
Their names are Crescent and Sunbeam. I designed them myself. It took a long time until I found a smith who was able to make them.
She looks like a pointy ear, too. Nature hasn't been kind to her.
For this absent-minded remark, Boindil receives evil looks from Namora and grins from the men.
Perhaps I really am an elf and will bring you a nightmare in your sleep tonight. Don't be surprised if you wake up screaming.
For a moment, it seems as though she has merged with the darkness, but when you blink, everything is back to normal.
By the gods! Isn't she magnificent in her role?
There is no denying what Rodario says. The all-too-familiar stench of tallow and grease reaches your nose. You know what this means.
Yes?
I'm on my way.
Huh?
What is it?
Yes? Why not? I'm on my way. All right, then. Understood. Why not? I'm on it. A victory for technology!
And what now?
What's up?
Why not?
Huh?
Yes, yes!
What is it? I'm on my way.
And again. Vile creature.
Welcome to the future. Why not? Target in sight. How many is that now? All right, then.
Let's go.
I'm on my way.
What is it?
All right, then. All right, then.
Huh? Come here,
yes, you.
Yeah.
Well.
And again.
Who's next?
Why not?
What is it? Ha ha! I'm with you! Yes, yes!
Who's next?
Huh?
Attack!
What's up?
Where the
wild creature? How many is that now?
At once.
Huh? I'm with you!
Yes? What is it?
Let's go!
What is it?
And again. Huh?
Vile creature.
Understood.
End it.
And again.
We hardly put up a fight.
Well, why not?
Huh?
Take my hammer!
Huh?
Huh? Yeah!
What is it? All right, then. Why not? Why not?
What's up? He won't last
and
long.
What now?
Come here, you!
Yes. Attack!
Well? How many is that now? I'll be ready again soon!
Huh?
And what now?
Disgusting.
Yes? Understood.
Yes?
What is it? Huzzah!
On my way.
For breakfast!
Huh? What's up?
Well?
Yeah?
Vile creature!
Yeah, why not?
Kill!
A victory for technology!
Vile personally!
Where the hell?
Huh? Understood.
Of course! What is it?
Yeah? What's up?
Why not? I'm on it.
My hammer!
On my way. End it!
Huh? I'm with you!
Yes?
Oi, right, little piggies!
Yeah.
End it!
What is it?
Yeah?
What is it?
Hmm?
Welcome to the future!
Was I?
Yes?
Yeah?
How many is
Take
that now?
Personally! Huh?
And what now? Come here, you!
Yeah!
Yes, yes!
Vile creature!
What's up? Hmm?
Why not?
Oh!
Yes?
Understood. I'm with you! Huh? Yes, yes! Of course!
And again!
Yes, yes!
Yeah?
Yes?
What's up? Of course!
Well?
Uh-huh. For Vrakus!
Hmm? Prepare yourself!
Yes. All right then.
Yes?
What is it?
And again.
What? What the hell were those things?
Goimgar carefully pokes one of the dead little creatures with his sword, as if he fears it will jump up and attack him.
Have you never defended your past, Simmerbeard? Those are Bognalim. Small, ugly, stinking, cowardly. Sound like anyone you know?
Goimgar looks angrily at Boindil and is going to reply, but Namora speaks first.
They are like little orcs. They are even more primitive and make up for their physical weakness through their sheer numbers. They live in caves all around here.
While the others talk about Bognalim, you examine a decorated ox skull that the orcs had with them. It wasn't made by them, and somehow looks valuable. You pocket it. You are walking past an inconspicuous copse as Namora suddenly stops on the spot.
Wait! We are not alone. Someone is watching us.
A trap?
Die, scum!
What are you doing? Why are you attacking us? We're dwarves too. We're on the same side.
I see honest dwarves here, but they are accompanied by scum. I will free you of it.
Oh, really? And what are you going to do on your own against eight?
You, come here.
What?
Brother, what are you doing?
Boindil, Boindil, what's wrong? Come to your senses!
It's no use. They belong to me. Now die, scum.
What is it?
Let's go! Of course!
Yes? Why not?
Uh-huh. On my way.
I'm not that quick! Taste my hammer!
What? Just a minute! On my way.
Even I am not that quick.
Yes, yes, do.
No sooner does the unknown dwarf fall unconscious to the floor than her control over your comrades disappears. You fetter and gag her until you know more about her sinister powers.
That was, I hope I didn't hurt you, Scholar.
It was as if in a dream, but at the same time, it wasn't. I heard her voice in my head, and although I knew better, I only saw orcs attacking me. You were the enemy.
Boindil goes over to the shackled dwarf and kicks her gently with his boot.
This is never a child of the smith, even if she looks like one. Those gifts. By Vrakas, there is something evil at work.
You kneel in front of the dwarf and press your axe against her throat.
My name is Tungdil. If I remove your gag, will you answer some questions?
The captive nods, and you pull the gag out of her mouth.
Geralda is my name. It would seem I underestimated you.
You said something about scum when you attacked us. Has Namora done anything to harm you?
Not her, but her kind. Alpha.
She is a human. She only acts at being an elf in theatre.
In the theatre?
For the first time, Geralda looks at Namora without a hateful expression.
She must die.
Your powers, I've never heard of anything like it.
Neither have I. I haven't had them for long. When I try to remember, all I see is black mist, and I taste iron and mud, and there's an elf who...
Did the Alpha give you these powers?
When I try to remember, it hurts, like needles sticking into my head. I am Geralda Bloodstone.
Where have you come from and what brings you to Weyen?
I was on my way to the Free Folk. They are said to live in the middle of Girdlegard, without kingdoms or their laws.
The Free Folk? You mean dwarves?
Yes. Dwarves who have left their kingdoms, voluntarily or otherwise. Not everyone has a place in their kingdom.
You instinctively think of your own plight. You are not a secondling, and won't be welcome among the fourthlings since you placed obstacles in their king's path.
Don't believe this nonsense, Scholar. The Free Folk are just a fairy tale that people tell themselves when they don't want to stick to the traditions. Just look what good it's done Geralda.
Geralda prepares to reply, but then she holds back.
Enough talk! She is dangerous, probably crazy. She attacked us, we should put an end to her.
It's what you call amnesia, memory loss, a tool often used in stage productions. We don't know what happened to her, and maybe she doesn't either. We can't just kill her.
She's too dangerous just to let go, so... Well, we'll take her with us. Remove the fetters.
You nip any objection in the bud and turn to Geralda.
Listen, I don't know what has happened to you, but we are dwarves and we shouldn't fight against one another. We could do with your help.
The female dwarf seems just as surprised by your decision as your companions.
I thank you. I would be happy to accompany you. I am Geralda Bloodstone of the Fourthling Kingdom. I'm sorry that I attacked you. It was a misunderstanding.
You realize that your decision doesn't please everyone. Boindil and Namora seem particularly upset. But they hold back, and you continue on your way, a slightly gloomy mood hanging over the group. When you enter the pretty little village with its richly ornate houses and its temple to Palandiel at its center, you can see an angry mob some distance away. The villagers are hassling a young woman, insulting her and pushing her to the ground. You push your way through the crowd of people and stand in the way of the villagers.
What's going on here?
A man dressed in richly decorated vestments looks you up and down.
Palandiel will be with you, dwarf. It is none of your business, but this woman here is a thief. She and her henchmen have emptied the monastery's granary and were willing to abandon us to our fate.
That's a lie. We asked for help and these people turned us away. I came back to ask again.
What evidence do you have against this woman?
We found the granary broken into. Almost a third of our grain and a significant amount of supplies have gone. And all this just one day after she and her people were snooping around here.
That isn't proof. It could simply be coincidence. Anyway, why would a thief come back to the scene of a crime?
The priest eyes you in silence, while some of the villagers make it clear that dwarves should keep their noses out of their business.
Tell us what happened.
The villagers grumble, but the priest gives the woman a chance to defend herself.
My name is Tavia. I was forced to flee Tabayin with my family when the perished land began to spread. My husband, we had to leave him behind.
The horror in the woman's eyes gives you a good idea as to what became of her husband.
No one accepted us in the north. There are too many refugees and everyone is scared. Queen Wei has offered land in Weyen to anyone who will work hard for it. But what should we grow if no one will sell us grain? We offered a fair price, but Father Malin...
She darts a scathing gaze at the priest.
He wanted double the amount.
The priest glances briefly at the angry villagers. Then he replies in a firm voice.
It was a hard winter, and with the increasing frequency of orc attacks, we must think of ourselves first and foremost. Even we cannot help everyone.
The bystanders mutter in agreement.
The accusations are serious, so let's get to the bottom of the matter to be completely sure.
We have no doubt that she did it.
The priest looks at the villagers standing around him, the lust for blood written in their faces.
On the other hand, before we do something we can't undo.
Dissatisfied murmuring grows, which the priest debates with mollifying gestures.
Search for your evidence. You there, lock this woman up in the guardhouse in the meantime.
The woman is taken into a squat building made of rough blocks of stone. The crowd slowly disbands. The priest is lost in thoughts, standing in front of the temple, as if he couldn't decide whether to go in or not.
I was wondering, what was here first, the temple or the village?
Ah, a keen eye. The temple is indeed much too big for such a small village. It was built on the foundations of an old stronghold when salt was found nearby. The village has grown over the years in the shadow of the temple. Good people live here, honest and pious children of Palandiel.
He glances at the place where the woman was surrounded.
Why can't we just be left in peace?
Supposing Tavia really did steal the grain and supplies, but only to save her family, would you turn a blind eye?
Palandiel teaches generosity, but that too must have its boundaries. We cannot help everyone. At some point, there won't be enough for us.
So, if you had sold the grain, the people of Seton would have starved?
Maybe not. Not yet. But if we always give everything we have away...
No one is saying always, and no one is saying everything.
The priest shrugs his shoulders apologetically. He doesn't wish to spoil things with his flock. You nod goodbye and the priest returns the gesture. You enter the village's large storehouse. The ground floor of the two-story building is full of turnips, with large barrels and clay pots on the floor and on high shelves. Several villagers are carrying out stock-taking. They're being supervised by a weedy man who observes them with a grim expression and writes things on a wax tablet every now and then. Work is in full swing. The man with the wax tablet grumbles now and then in agreement when one of the peasants shouts out a number to him. It shouldn't take too much longer until they finish the inventory. There are sacks piled up on top of one another on the first floor. They are most likely filled with different kinds of grain and, judging by the omnipresent white dust, flour. You look around for a portable source of light.
Can anyone see a candle or a torch? I need a light.
I wouldn't recommend that.
The Magister Technicus has followed you into the storehouse.
One spark could ignite the flower dust. We sometimes use the effect when we want to create huge balls of fire on the stage.
I think we could do without huge balls of fire in here.
You walk towards the only area in the storeroom where you can see the floorboards. You hesitate as your boots slip on the floor, as if you're walking on mud.
Tungdil.
The Magister Technicus carefully observes the roof beams above the empty corner. He grabs at a beam and crumbles something between his fingers. You can't make out what it is, so you copy him and feel damp, rotten wood. It's very easy to pull away small pieces.
What are you doing here?
The man with the wax tablet is standing on the stairs. He sounds half angry, half shocked.
No one is allowed in here!
Who are you? What are you doing here if no one is allowed to be here?
I'm allowed to be here. It's my job. I'm the steward of the temple. Morris is my name.
The rain has gotten here. The roof and the floor are damp.
Those savages. It wasn't enough that they steal from us. They had to damage the roof too. That was probably where they got in.
The wood didn't start to rot yesterday, good man.
The steward's face turns bright red.
And you are the experts on such things, are you?
Assuming the roof here has been leaky for a long time, what would have happened to the grain in the sacks directly underneath? Wouldn't it have turned rotten?
The man wets his lips. His gaze darts around the room.
The roof was fine. I'll have it repaired. And now, get out of here!
The steward angrily blocks off all further attempts at talking to him. And even when you threaten him with Father Malin, it doesn't have the desired effect. The father trusts in him, he says, and he's always been a devout follower. The heavy door of the storehouse closes behind you, and you hear a bolt sliding into place from the inside. The priest is lost in thoughts, standing in front of the temple, as if he couldn't decide whether to go in or not.
The roof of the granary is leaky. We saw some rotten wooden planks.
Again? Morris only had the roof repaired last summer.
Did he? If he didn't, some of the grain would have got damp and rotten.
Out of the question. Morris would have reported that. He checks the grain once a month and there were no complaints.
The priest has absolutely no doubt in what he is saying. Often a sign that someone hasn't thought things over. You nod goodbye. And the priest returns the gesture. You enter the guardhouse, and before the guards know, Boindiel and Boendal have caught them up in a friendly conversation. Shielded from the view of the guards, you exchange a few words with the suspect without being disturbed.
Why did you come back to the village?
I wanted to negotiate with Father Malin for the grain. What else could I do? No sooner had I arrived than they surrounded me and accused me of robbery.
Where have you taken the grain and supplies?
I don't know anything about grain or supplies. Apart from the fact that we could do with both, I'm telling you, I am innocent!
We won't let anyone do anything to you, but if we are going to help you, you will have to tell us the truth.
The woman looks you in the face, then her head sinks, and when she looks back up, she has tears in her eyes.
Please, I just want to go back to my family. I don't know what happened.
Tungdil.
You feel sympathy towards the woman. You raise your hand to silence Rodario and nod to the woman to continue talking.
We asked for grain and were full of hope when we saw the well-filled granary. But we hadn't reckoned on the malice of the people here.
A slow, ironic clap sounds from behind you. Confused, you turn around to face Rodario.
Bravo, my dear, with tears and everything. Tough luck that a master of the art of acting is present. None of what she said corresponds with the truth, Tungdil. She is lying and trying to deceive us. Not completely talentless, for an amateur.
You expect the woman to deny everything, but when she overcomes her amazement, she spits in the actor's face.
And what if I am? I would do it all again. The people here have more than they need, and my people are starving. Is that fair?
Spit it out. Where are the spoils and your people?
I'd rather die than tell you that.
The woman looks at you determinedly, and neither of you blink.
Why did you come back here after stealing the grain and supplies?
We didn't steal them. We paid for them. A reasonable price, just not to Father Malin.
You had help?
He promised us 3 dozen sacks of grain. When we opened the sacks in our hideout, we realised that most of the grain was rotten. He thought he'd get away with it.
The woman looks around wearily.
And by the looks of things, he has.
Morris the steward offered you the grain, didn't he?
What does that matter? I've no proof it was him. And even if I did, if I admit that we have the stuff, I'll be hanging from a tree by this evening and my children will starve. I beg you, let me go. We bought the grain and the supplies. Perhaps he wasn't allowed to sell it to us. But we paid. And with the little seed we can sow, at least some of us have a chance of surviving the year.
How can I trust you? You lied.
Who wouldn't do everything to offer their children a future? Lying is the very least.
You've stolen, no matter how you put it. But perhaps Father Malin will show clemency if you return the grain.
Clemency for me and a death sentence for my family. Never.
I don't want you to be hanged just because you tried to support your family. Go.
You open the door. The guards jump up, take up their swords, and let their hands sink down again when they feel the axes of the dwarves against their throats. The woman lays a hand on your shoulder for a moment as a sign of gratitude before she runs from the guardhouse.
I hope you know what you're doing, scholar.
Rodario's furrowed brow does not give you the feeling you've made an undisputed decision.
Nomura, find out where she's heading, and then rejoin us.
Fergus wants to raise an objection, but before he can think of the right words, Nomura has kissed him on the mouth and has disappeared round the next corner. You leave the guardhouse and explain your plan to Father Malin. You expect him to object, but he seems to be satisfied. You assume he'll make you responsible for everything if something goes wrong, and will claim a piece for himself if you are successful. Like every night in the wilderness, you set up camp and assign the watch. Bavrigor takes first watch this evening, while the rest of you sit by a small fire, toasting some bread. You're not particularly surprised that neither Bavrigor nor any of the others notice the guest who suddenly appears out of the darkness next to you.
Nomura!
Fergus jumps up and moments later has embraced her tightly.
Were you able to find out anything?
She didn't detect me and led me straight to the hideout. I can show you. It's a cave some miles off from the path. Almost 4 dozen people, men, women, and children.
You nod. You have tracked down Tavia's hideout. When you enter the strongly fortified mountain village, you see a large group of miners standing around a shaft in heated discussion.
I really saw them, I swear!
A young man in mining clothes defiantly stares at an older man who is a good head taller than him.
Even if you did, smashing the lift hoist, it would have been better to have not sent the cage down again until we cleared this thing up.
Is there a problem?
The older man, perhaps a foreman, is so angry that he hardly seems to have realized that he's talking to a dwarf.
Mika here says that he saw orcs in the mine, and he smashed the lift hoist to bits. The cage has crashed to the bottom of the shaft. How are we supposed to work now?
I would say he did the right thing. If the orcs have managed to come up through the mine, then you all might be dead.
I heard the hideous grunting and the stench. It was unbearable. You should have been there. I just wanted to save the village.
The young man and the foreman look at each other in silence for a few seconds.
All right. Mika might not be the sharpest tool in the box, but the boy has guts. If he says there were orcs down there, then there were orcs down there. But the problem remains, we can't work without the lift.
Can we help you somehow?
Help? Well, we'll have to repair the hoist, and we need a new cage.
The foreman turns to a man next to him for answers. He's just as muscular, with dirty, calloused hands and an angular face.
It will take at least 2 weeks, but we don't need any help, unless you can speed up time.
I'll need 1 day, 2 at the most, if there are problems.
The foreman looks aghast at the technicus, unsure whether he's joking or not.
1 day? Have you got any idea how...
Fergus is the most talented Magister Technicus in Girdleguard. And anyway, what have you got to lose? Let him help.
As long as he doesn't get in my way...
The worker shrugs his shoulders.
Why not?
Good, we'll help you. And we don't want anything in return.
Ooh, that's generous.
The foreman looks at you distrustfully. He's the sort of person who doesn't like being indebted to others. Fergus immediately gets to work examining the hoist. After a few moments, he sends Mika off with a list of tools and spare parts and explains to you how to build the cage, while he takes care of the hoist's rustic mechanism. After half a day, the cage is operational again, but Fergus is still busy with the hoist. You just hear him muttering.
So far, there is no automatic brake in case the ropes snap, but it shouldn't be too hard to fit one.
Fergus decides to fit the automatic brake, but it takes more time than expected. Building the hoist from scratch would have been simple, but the upgrade turns out to be complicated. In the end, it takes 2 days until the lift is operational again. After the work is done, you report to the foreman. A huge grin spreads across the foreman's face. You have just saved him a lot of time and effort.
We can't let you leave empty-handed.
Here, at least take some provisions for your journey. And if you ever need some extra brute force against the orcs, I'm sure we can find 10 men who'd be happy to learn from you.
People here, so far away from civilization, know how to look after themselves. The men have broad shoulders, strong hands, and look as though they'd know how to fight off orcs. However, you can't persuade them to join in the attack with you.
There are too few here. The orc camp is huge. Organize some more help, then we'll come with you.
You travel down into the mine in the repaired lift. Mika shows you the place where he saw the orcs, and you follow the winding gallery. After 1,000 paces, you stopped counting. And only after several hours do you reach an exit. There's a stench of tallow in the air. The tunnel leads directly into a huge orc camp, which blocks the pass into Snowdale Valley. If you attacked from here, you'd have the element of surprise on your side.
I could go and take a look and perhaps improve our chances for an attack.
You remember how the actor had transformed himself into Lot Yonin and Nudin in Mephidania. You certainly wouldn't bet against him being able to walk through the orc camp unnoticed.
I'll come with you. If I stay in the shadows, they won't see me.
The actor nods gratefully.
I'll come too. I also know how to keep myself hidden.
Nomura wants to object, but you are quicker.
Thank you, Geralda. Two more eyes and ears would be helpful on such a mission. Listen, try to sabotage their defenses, and if you can safely take out a couple of guards, then do it. But don't take any big risks. Come back here if things get too hairy.
Nomura and Rodario rejoin you without any particular urgency. The infiltration was a complete success. No one detected the two of them. The group isn't overly friendly towards Geralda, and this evening she's sitting once again apart from the others. You ask yourself what you can do to break the ice when you see that she has a file in her hand. The file is wrapped around with silver wire and has a snap lock. The liquid in it is black. Geralda opens the lid and takes a big swig. As she puts down the bottle, a smile flits across her face, followed by a short expression of deep satisfaction. It is the first time that you have seen a positive emotion on the face of the somber dwarf.
Is that medicine?
No, it's... I don't know either. If I don't drink it, I have a longing for it. It gets stronger and stronger until I can't stand it anymore. When I drink it, the longing disappears, and I feel rested and strong.
And when the phial's empty?
I don't know. I don't know where I got the drink from, let alone what it is. But if I don't drink it, Frackers, give me strength. I think I would go crazy or die.
Geralda plays with the phial, lost in her thoughts, as if she were trying to remember where she saw it for the first time. A two-story tavern sits on the corner of a crossroads. The snow around the building has been cleared away, and a warm light is coming from inside. The sign above the door reads, Minstrel Castle.
Minstrel Castle? That sounds promising.
building has nothing in common with a castle. It seems rather nondescript. A simple tavern for simple people.
Finally! Time for ale! My throat is completely parched!
As much as I hate agreeing with you, I too can hardly wait.
You enter the tavern with Bavrigor and Boindil in front. On first impression, the interior is as inconspicuous as the outside. But when you take a closer look, you spot a couple of paintings of minstrels in front of a castle, a small stage that, judging by the dust, is only very rarely used, and a lute hanging on the wall behind the bar. There are not very many guests on the ground floor, perhaps a dozen, and most of them belong to a group of mercenaries who have retreated into the far corner. You sit at a table, and after a while you are brought the ale that Boindil has ordered.
Good day, gentlemen.
Get lost, Groundlin.
Be quiet! The good dwarf may want to make use of our services if you stop insulting him.
The mercenary immediately becomes sheepish and concentrates on his tankard of beer.
My name is Gurnam, the leader of this troop.
Pleased to meet you, Mr. Gurnam. I am Tungdil Goldhand. I actually do wish to inquire after your services against an orc camp in the west.
The leader of the mercenaries looks at you, trying to size you up.
You and your companions look as though you know how to handle your weapons. Must be a damn big orc camp.
Otherwise, we wouldn't ask for your help. So, are you in?
Why not? 500 gold coins for me and 9 of my men in advance.
You go back to the mercenaries. They look up briefly before turning back to their drinks.
So, have you made your decision, dwarf?
You send Namora to try and haggle down the price of the mercenaries.
If it will help against the orcs. Hey guys, we need your help with a couple of orcs. Name your price.
The men look up, and as they see who is standing in front of them, their faces brighten.
We wouldn't take money from someone like you, sweetheart. I'm sure you can show your appreciation in other ways.
Namora says nothing. She stares into the man's eyes, and he falls silent. He seems to shrink and to have lost the capacity to talk. Finally, Namora looks away and turns to go.
All right, then. I'll find someone else.
Wait, stay here, darling.
The young mercenary jumps up and tries to hold Namora back by the arm, but she sidesteps quickly and he grasps at thin air. He trips over Namora's foot, which just happens to be in the right place, and clatters to the floor.
Oh, come on, boys. Don't you know how to treat a lady?
The leader of the mercenaries smiles at Namora, revealing several missing teeth.
For such a beautiful woman like you, we'll make a very special price. For 250 gold pieces, we'll demonstrate what we're capable of.
You ask Radario to negotiate with the mercenaries. Happy to be able to demonstrate his skills, the actor steps over to the mercenaries' table.
My dear fellows, if I may introduce myself, I am the fabulous Radario.
Huh? What do you want?
Without even waiting for Radario to introduce himself, one of the younger mercenaries interrupts him. Radario isn't put off his stride for long and starts again.
Well, what I wanted to say is that I immediately recognize you as a group of experienced warriors who have already won several, if not even innumerable, battles. But have you ever received the recognition that you deserve? A gifted poet like me could write a fantastic drama about your stories.
A play?
Indeed, your legend will live forever. Generations of people will talk about you.
And you're saying that wouldn't happen anyway?
While Radario is still looking for a suitable answer, the mercenary laughs.
I'm just pulling your leg. Now get lost. We don't need verse. We need money.
You nod at the mercenaries before you turn away and walk back to the others. You go to the bar where the landlady is working and sit on a stool. The landlady, a stout, middle-aged woman with long hair tied in a ponytail, looks up briefly but says nothing.
Say, why is the tavern called Minstrel Castle? It doesn't look much like a castle.
Oh, you don't know the legend, dwarf.
One of the guests next to you at the bar takes up your question.
There was a castle here once. No one knows its name anymore. So everyone just calls it Minstrel Castle. Once upon a time, a king lived in that castle. He had many subjects and an enchanting queen. But one day a young minstrel came along and sang of wonderful far-off lands. And the subjects began to complain about their own lives. So the king sent for the singer to hear for himself. He came and sang a wonderful love song. And the king began to be scared. He thought that the minstrel wanted to steal away his queen. Without flinching, he drew his sword and struck the boy down. His father heard of this. He was himself a singer. And so he went to the king and played a terrible song, a curse. The king was to vanish in silence, and no one was to remember his name.
And that's what happened. No one remembers the name of the king or his castle. Make of it what you will. The story's certainly well known enough in the area to give Arryn its name.
You nod at the landlady as you slip off the barstool, and she nods back. You go back to the mercenaries. They look up briefly before turning back to their drinks.
So, have you made your decision, dwarf?
Here is your payment. 250 gold coins.
You place a pouch containing the counted coins on the table in front of Gurnam.
We will seize the orc camp with you, and then perhaps celebrate a bit.
He grins over at Namora, who manages with some effort to avoid killing the mercenary. Bavrigor and Boindil, who are absorbed in a drinking competition, have to be practically dragged out of the tavern. But in the end, you are able to continue your journey. You arrive at an empty jetty on Lake Anterior. You can see several fishing boats on the lake, and there's a small village on the other shore.
Ah, Polebrook, what an idyllic little place. And then there's the miller's daughter.
Hey there, would you be able to ferry us over to the other side?
At first you think the fisherman hasn't heard you, but then he turns around and heads towards the shore. When the boat has almost reached you, the fisherman calls back.
Dwarves, are you lost? Oh well, whatever. I am Samuel. If you wish to cross, it'll cost you food for 10 days or 20 gold, whichever you prefer.
You give Samuel the gold, and after a long discussion with the dwarves in the group, you follow him onto the boat. The dwarves literally leap out of the boat as soon as you reach dry land.
We could have died! I hope it was worthwhile, scholar!
As on the previous evening, Bavrigor sits apart from the others. But tonight, he waves you over.
Smeralda, my sister. You want to know what happened, right?
You nod and sit down.
She followed Boindle into battle. We tried to talk her out of it, but she was as unyielding as a mountain. Then came the day when the High Pass was attacked.
Bavrigor drinks from his liquor.
He killed her. Blinded by the frenzy of battle, he thought she was one of the enemy. I can never forgive him. He killed my sister. Could you?
You inevitably remember the loss of Lotjonen, Frala, and her children. You remain sitting in silence, each of you deep in thought. Boendal approaches, having either heard you or guessing what you were talking about.
His fierce life forge is a curse. He thought the orcs had robbed him of his love, and the ire came over him. Sometimes he calls her name in his dreams. Oh, he'd never admit it, but he suffers just like Bavrigor. He too loved her.
The stonemason doesn't react, so you and Boendal go back to the others by the fire. You can make out a cave in the bank of a dried-out riverbed, with several small fires burning in it. You don't see any guards, so you approach carefully. Men and women jump as they notice you. There is terror written in their emaciated faces. When a little girl screams and runs away from you, the whole camp is alerted, and a group of men and women step out of the cave.
Is that them? Your benefactors?
Tavia, who came out of the cave next to the man, nods.
You've led them straight here.
Who are you?
The man resembles Tavia. His face, too, tells of a struggle between defiant determination and fatigue and resignation.
I am Gerald, Tavia's brother. I led these people here from Tabayin.
You look around you. You guess there are about 10 families, less than 50 people. Half of them are children and youths.
Your sister couldn't have known that she was being followed. Namora has quite a talent for not being seen.
She shouldn't even have gone to Seton in the first place. I knew that nothing good would come of it.
Tabayin is a fertile country in the north, but much more importantly these days, it borders the Perish land to the east.
How are things in Tabayin?
Gerald's expression changes. It's as if he's looking through you.
The Perish land is raging. It poisons the spirit, and those who become possessed by it just...
Gerald looks at his hands, which he involuntarily forms into claws.
They no longer recognize you. Brothers, mothers, children. My brother-in-law. I had to...
With visible effort, he wrenches himself free of his terrible memories.
We can only hope that the Magi manage to build a new barrier soon.
You cannot bring yourself to quash the last hope he has.
Tavia went to Seton on her own initiative.
Our gold was gone and our supplies were dwindling, despite being on half rations. I said we should just take what we need if no one is going to help us, but my sister wouldn't have anything to do with it. She took the wedding jewelry from our village, the most valuable thing we had with us, and sold it without my knowing. She then took this money and went to Seton with several men. I was completely beside myself when I heard about it, but then they came back with food and grain, and I thought they had really done it.
He laughs cheerlessly and shakes his head.
For a few minutes, we thought we were saved.
What's wrong with the grain from Seton?
We thought we finally had a change of luck for the better. We were praying for a new start, but then we discovered that most of the grain was rotten and unusable. They'd been ripped off by the bloody steward. We all got together and discussed what was to be done. The majority was in favour of going to Seton and taking what was due, at any price. The next morning, Tavia disappeared. It was clear to me that she had returned to Seton. We were going to give her a couple of days, and in the meantime, we prepared for our attack. We needed weapons, and we needed a plan.
The supplies and the grain, where are they?
Gerald glances at your companions.
The grain is mainly useless. There's only 4 or 5 usable sacks. We shared out the supplies, and that'll keep us going for the next few weeks.
If you return the grain, Father Malin may temper justice with mercy.
Mercy?
Gerald spits at the floor.
Let my people starve so that the people in Seton can live in affluence for another year. No, I won't let my family die. The grain and the supplies stay here.
Gerald braces himself, placing his right hand on his axe.
We should appease the people of Seton. Give them back half their grain.
You raise your hand to nip Gerald's objection in the bud.
I am, of course, talking about the rotten grain. You keep the good grain, we will receive at least part of our reward, and Morris will be forced to explain how his excellent grain could turn rotten so quickly.
Boindale stares at you. Then a grin slowly spreads across his face.
Ha! That's our scholar!
You see tired but happy faces all around you. The people breathe a collective sigh of relief.
We'll take half of the grain back in secret. Know this, good dwarf. Whenever you need help, we will stand by your side. We don't have much to offer you, but we can muster together a few strong arms for battle, and we have some outstanding archers.
You nod and are happy to have made some new friends.
We wouldn't ask if it wasn't important, but we need your help to destroy an orc stronghold.
Gerald nods.
We're in your debt. We'll send our 5 best archers.
So long, my friend.
The size of the fields and the farmsteads grow as you get closer to Varentiensis, the old border city in the north. The old city wall is much too small for the size of today's settlement. Everywhere little cottages and even the odd magnificent estate extend beyond the wall.
Varentiensis. Ah. This city is home to the Grand Archive. There are countless works from all over Girdlegard here. I wonder whether we'll be allowed to go in.
You try to gain access to the city, but the guards on the wall are unyielding. The orc armies in the south and the movement of the Perish Land has prompted the city council to lock Varentiensis up. You try not to show your disappointment, but Boindale looks at you curiously.
Is a house full of dusty books really that important, scholar? That's no place for a dwarf.
There are also books by dwarves and about dwarves in that archive. They've practically got everything that has ever been written. They've even got notes on the races of Girdlegard, Singularities and Oddities, by M.A. Hett.
A book about dwarves? That really can't be any good at all.
You leave the impressive city of Varentiensis behind you and continue on your way. You discover some ancient ruins and an orc camp in a gorge. A small group of Bognalim is moving between tents, piles of rubbish and cages. In one of the cages, you think you can make out some movement.
They're coming out the holes.
You there, my bag! Over there! Quick! You'll have to smoke them out!
What's up?
Grenades! Throw them into the holes. That ought to stop the little beasts.
Let's go!
Yes? At once.
What is it? Yes!
What is it? Of course!
Yeah? Of course!
Vile creature!
Let's go! Yes? Over there?
Huh?
Attack! And what now? Come here, you!
Hmm?
And again!
Of course! He hardly put up a fight!
Kill!
Hmm?
What's up?
And again!
Disgusting! Let's go!
Yes?
Huh?
And what now? I'm with you!
Yeah?
Hmm?
Yes? Huh?
Huh?
Kill!
He hardly put up a fight!
Of course!
And again!
And what now?
What's up?
Yes?
Personally,
kill.
I'm on it. Your death is on its way.
Huh?
Of course.
Enjoy
yourself.
Huh?
Hmm?
What is it? Just a minute.
Ha ha.
And again!
Die! That's it! Your death is on its way!
Very impressive, I must say. Let me out, my friends.
Pile of wood, or is it actually a pyre? A bowl. It looks as though things have been burned in it. Perhaps offerings for a deity. A bowl. It looks as though... An improvised bracket on which you could hang something.
Oh, thank you. Have you seen Helga? Helga? Gorgo! Where are you?
Hello? I am Tungdil Goldhand. These are my companions, Boindil, Boendal, Radario, Fergus and Namora, Bavrigor and Goimgar.
Have you seen Elga?
No, we haven't. If you don't mind me asking, what is your name?
Call me Ensign and drop the pleasantries.
If I may, who is this Helga?
Helga? Where?
I don't know. I just wanted to know.
Helga is my wife. Didn't I mention that? We came here together, but then the orcs came and she was gone. Do you think she might have gone home? Helga!
You have a dark notion of what might have happened to Helga, but as you have no proof, you'd rather say nothing.
If you see her, you let me know, right?
I wanted to thank you. Your grenades really helped us.
Grenades? Oh, yeah, no problem. I used them to break up boulders, but I ended up attracting these pests. Who wish to know there are Bognalim around here? And as if that weren't bad enough, along came the orcs and took me ox skull. Crash! And Helga. Where is Helga?
What brings you to these parts, Ensign? It's not exactly the nicest of places.
Aren't you here for the festival? The unbelievable Wackenstein Festival? My wife and I desperately wanted to see it for ourselves. The Blind Guardian, the statue over there, is the key. He calls people from far and wide to the festival. I finally found some information in the archives of Virunciensis as to how the Guardian is activated.
Do you know anything about a secret passage through the mountains?
Secret passage? No, can't say I do. But they say that when the Blind Guardian awakens, then people will come to the festival from all corners of the world. Maybe they'll come from the mountains too.
So what have you found out about the festival, Henson?
You see that statue? That's the Blind Guardian. You could call him the patron saint of Wackenstein. They say that when the festival begins, then the revelers heed his call from all corners of the earth. According to my research, we need three things to start the festival. A burning ox skull, the fire-eater bell, and vervain. I actually had it all, but, then the orcs came.
It should be easy to find an ox's skull. All we have to do is find a butcher.
Oh, it can't just be any old ox skull. In these special decorations and engravings. Took me weeks to prepare that skull. Then the orcs came and took it. Must have thought it had some value.
Is it this one here?
Stone the crows, you already have it. Excellent. That is a good omen.
And what do we do with it?
Oh, well, that's simple. The ox skull must be set on fire.
You're not sure what kind of celebration needs a burning ox skull, but the mission doesn't sound too difficult.
Where will we find the fire eater bell, and what kind of a name is that anyway?
Virunciensis. I'll track you down to a collector who lives outside the city in an estate on the south wall. According to the legend, the bell was mounted in a black tower. The tower caught fire. The bell fell down and smothered the source of the fire. Now, I'm sure you can work out the rest. The ringing of the bell opens the way for the blazing fire in our souls. At least that's what is written.
Virunciensis. So what are we waiting for? We'll visit the collector and...
It would be best if he went without me. I have some things to prepare here.
Vervain, doesn't that grow in Ergon? It's a hell of a long way from here.
Ha! Don't worry. I have a bag, just a minute. It's gone.
You lost it?
Well, lost. I mean, you know,
Briefly mislaid, perhaps. It must be here somewhere.
To begin the festival, we need the ox skull, the fire eater bell, and the vervain, right?
Exactly. Then we need to set the skull on fire, ring the bell, and burn the herbs. And then it happens.
You're quite sure you're wasting your time. A huge festival in the middle of nowhere. But you pin your hopes on there being a spark of truth in every story, and that somehow a path will open up through the mountains when you carry out the old ritual.
See you later, Ensign.
Let me know if you see Helga.
Ah, that must be Henson's bag of herbs. Henson, do you have a...
Have you found out?
See you later.
Let me know.
All right. Something's not quite right.
Your feet carry you back to Varentiensis, home of the Grand Archive. On the south wall is a house whose owner, according to Henson, has the Fire Eater Bell in his possession. You follow the street to an estate on the south wall, which is surrounded by a fence. The paved path to the door is lined with hydrangea. You knock on the door gently. And after a while, it is opened by a chubby man in expensive clothes. The man gives you a fleeting glance.
We don't want to buy anything.
He intends to close the door again without waiting for your answer. You put your foot in the crack of the door.
Wait, you have a rare bell in there, Fire Eater, am I right?
The man pauses.
Fire Eater? How?
Before he can finish what he's saying, a red-haired woman pushes past him. She is also wearing expensive clothes and is heavily made up. After she gives him a stern look, the man disappears into the house. She scrutinizes you with greenish-blue eyes.
How do you know about that, Shorty?
A man called Henson.
Henson? The vagabond that broke into our house? But now he's sending groundlings to assassinate us and steal our belongings. What did he tell you? That we have gold, jewels?
No. Henson is our adversary. We want to snatch the bell away from under his nose.
The woman's eyes pierce through you. You manage with great effort to resist her gaze.
I'd like to get that ugly thing out of the house. All right, then. I'll sell you the bell for 500 gold pieces.
That really is too expensive. Perhaps we can...
Before you know it, the door is slammed shut in your face. You go back to the rest of the group.
Doesn't look like it went too well. Maybe I should try my luck, Tangdil. I can be very persuasive.
Redario follows the hydrangea-lined path to the door in elegant strides. He knocks on the door energetically, and a little later the door is opened by a red-headed woman. When she sees Redario, her expression lightens. She opens the door fully and takes a tentative step forward.
What can I do for you? Are you a singer? An actor? Or a lute player?
The name is Redario, fair maid. Gifted showman, mime and dramatist. At your service.
Redario elegantly pulls the hat from his head and bows before her.
Your wonderful hydrangeas really caught my attention. You have exquisite taste.
The woman's greenish-blue eyes sparkle at his charm, and Redario can't deny himself a smile, confident of victory.
Oh, you are a real charmer, Mr. Redario. I'm sure you flatter all the ladies like this, don't you?
Oh, no. By no means, my love. I just can't avoid it when I see beauty such as yours.
Oh, don't play with my feelings, Mr. Redario. You probably haven't even noticed the color of my eyes.
She playfully turns her head away to hide her face.
I will never be able to forget your greenish-blue eyes as long as I live.
A smile follows, then a glance from those eyes, which are indeed a greenish-blue.
It would seem to me you have a skilled tongue and a love of details.
Anyone who does not notice your beauty must be walking through life with eyes closed, in terms of my tongue.
Oh, Mr. Redario! How about a private presentation of your skills?
Redario lays an experienced hand around the woman's waist and disappears into the house with her.
At your service, my dear.
After an hour, Redario comes out of the house with a broad grin on his face and the bell in a bag.
The bell, as ordered. Apart from the esteemed Namora, no woman has ever resisted my sweet words. Not to mention my hands when...
All right, all right.
You feel your cheeks turning red as you imagine what Redario has just done. The familiar jetty is empty, but you can see Samuel on his boat, halfway between here and Polbrook, and you call him over.
So, we meet again. You want to get across to the other side, I presume? I'll ferry you across for 10 provisions or 20 gold.
Not at the moment, thank you.
Well, no skin off my nose. If you change your mind, you know where to find me.
Your path leads you once again to the Minstrel Castle Tavern. The warm, familial glimmer from inside is, as ever, inviting. You enter the tavern again and sit at a free table. As usual, Boindil orders a round of ale, which is promptly brought over. You go to the bar where the landlady is working and sit on a stool. The landlady, a stout, middle-aged woman with long hair, tied in a ponytail, looks up briefly but says nothing. You nod at the landlady as you slip off the barstool, and she nods back. Bavrigor and Boindil, who are absorbed in a drinking competition, have to be practically dragged out of the tavern. But in the end, you are able to continue your journey. You enter Seaton and take a look round. The priest is lost in thoughts, standing in front of the temple, as if he couldn't decide whether to go in or not.
We have found the thieves' hideout.
Really? That's welcome news.
With an encouraging nod, the priest of Palandiel prompts you to continue.
We spoke to the people there. It was very revealing.
And?
The priest gives you the same look he otherwise uses to reprimand the villagers' minor sins.
They say they paid Morris to sell supplies and grain to them.
The priest wants to object.
He ripped them off. That would be an explanation as to why Tavia came back this morning, don't you think?
The cogs are turning inside the priest's head. His expression reveals that he doesn't like his own conclusions.
And what about the grain and the supplies?
The refugees must have been very hungry. They'd already eaten the supplies by the time we arrived at the camp. We were able to secure most of the sacks of grain. We'll take them to the storehouse.
The priest eyes you in silence, and you look back without batting an eyelid.
Very well. You have earned this, Mr. Dwarf.
The priest brings out a pouch. He thinks for a moment, and then pulls another smaller pouch from his robes and gives it you.
It is time that my congregation concentrates once more on the essentials in life, togetherness, and the compassion of the goddess.
He leaves you standing there without another word. The village seems much emptier than on your last visit. Most of the workers must now be underground. People here, so far away from civilization, know how to look after themselves. The men have broad shoulders, strong hands, and look as though they'd know how to fight off orcs.
You helped us, we'll help you. We're miners, but we know how to look after ourselves. If you want to attack the orcs, we could help you with 10 men.
The guards are much more alert now since the infiltration of the orc camp. You have delivered a serious blow to your enemy, and an attack should now be significantly easier. The mercenaries, the miners, and Gerald's people are waiting for your signal to attack. You probably can't expect to receive any more support. You enter the orc camp with your companions. You have a long way ahead of you.
At your service.
What's up? Of course.
Oh. Excellent choice.
Huh? At once.
What is it? I'm with you. Huzzah!
Yes? On my way. At once.
What is it?
Yeah?
And what now?
Over there.
Gladly.
Who's next?
Take it at personally. Your service.
Excellent choice.
Huh?
Attack!
Huh?
What's up? Of course. And what now? Of course! A bit too much for you,
yes,
was
yes.
I?
Oh! I understand.
Huh?
Disgusting. What is it? What's up?
What's your service?
My hammer! Of course!
Huh?
Don't take it for...
Certainly!
And what now?
Creature.
Huzzah!
Kill
him! A bit too much for you, was I? He won't last long. Hey! Bit too many over here! There, we're not!
Aye. Over there.
Glad.
Excellent choice.
Is it?
Yeah?
Aye.
Huh?
Yeah!
And it talks!
Yeah!
Fabricus!
Huh?
Hmm?
Oh!
And what now?
Kill!
Of course! I'm with you! Yes, yes!
Yeah?
At your service?
Yes?
Attack!
Yeah!
Attack!
Uh-huh. Yes?
On my way. At once.
End it!
Huh?
On my way.
And what now?
Who's next?
Huzzah!
What's up? Yeah?
At your service?
Yes.
What is it?
Aye. Huh?
Huh? Ha ha! Come here, you! Ha ha! Of course! Yes, yes! I'm with you! Yes, yes! Of course! I'm with you!
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yes?
What is it?
I'm not that quick!
At your service.
Huh?
And what now? Huzzah!
Come here, you!
Of course!
Yeah.
Ooh!
Die? Huh?
Huh?
Service?
Huh?
What is it?
Yes?
At your service. Excellent choice.
Who's next?
I. Over there, gladly. At your service.
What is it?
Of course!
I'm with you!
Die. Oh, excellent choice. Die. I understand. Excellent choice.
Yes?
And what now?
Of course.
Yes, yes. Hardly put up a fight. Come here, you. Who's next? Huzzah!
Oh. Over there, Black. Die. I understand. At your service.
Hardly put up a fight. What is it? Hardly put up a fight. Ha ha! Ha ha!
Of course.
I. Over there, glad. I understand. Oh. Over there, Glad. Die.
Huh? Come here, you.
Understood.
Oh. I understand. Excellent choice. I understand. At your service.
Yes?
What's up?
Of course.
Uh-huh. And again.
And what now?
He won't last long.
Excuse me, but I'm going to have to do this.
Don't take it personally.
What is it?
End it! Kill!
What's up?
Taste my hammer!
Yes? Attack! For Vrakus!
And what now?
Another victory? Aye?
Oh, this is going to be bloody.
A bit too much for you, was I?
Your demise was inevitable.
He won't last long. Taste my hammer.
What is it?
Don't take it personally.
Who's next?
What's up?
At once. For Vrakus!
Too much for you, was I?
Yeah. He put up a fight!
And again!
And what now?
Huh? On my way. End it!
Yourself. Let's go. He won't last.
He already put up a fight.
Of course.
And what now?
What is it?
Yes.
Let's go!
Yes, yes! Come here, you!
Don't take it personally.
Of course!
Die? Excellent choice. Over there,
glad.
I understand. Over there,
glad.
I understand. Well fought. Your demise was inevitable. Another victory? I understand. Over there,
glad.
I understand. At your service.
What is it?
Aye. Ah, I understand. At your service.
Huh? Attack!
Prepare yourself! Guys. And what now?
Oh. Over there.
Glad.
At your service. Your demise was inevitable.
Taste my hammer!
Yes?
End it!
What is it? I? At your service.
Prepare yourself!
Uh-huh.
For Vrakus! Vile creature! A bit too much for you, was I? Huh? Who's next?
Of course!
And again!
Why not?
Prepare yourself!
Don't take it personally! Aye?
Huh?
And what
at
now?
At service?
Huh?
End Huzzah! It!
Huh? Understood.
What is it?
Ha ha!
He hardly put up a fight! Huzzah! Of course! Huh? A bit too much for you, was I?
Uh-huh. Yes?
Yes.
Oh, wait,
disgusting.
Just use my hand. I don't have to do this.
End it.
Another victory at your service. Oh.
Yes, yes,
gladly.
Taste my
hammer! This is going to be bloody.
Let's go!
There, why not?
Uh-huh.
End it!
Aye. En garde!
Yes?
Yeah! Yeah?
He hardly put up a fight. I understand. Oh. Ha ha. Aye. Over there.
Gladly.
Excellent choice. Ah, I understand. At your service. Over there.
Gladly.
Excellent choice. Over there.
Gladly.
Die. Well fought.
Huh?
Oh, wait, yo.
Another victory!
And what now?
At your service.
Huh?
Huh?
Yes?
Let's go!
Huh? Understood.
Danger! Your
and
comrade is in danger!
He won't last long.
Huh?
What is it?
Wait, little piggies!
Yes? On my way. Huh?
Yeah? Of course! Prepare yourself!
At your service?
Die?
Huh? For Vrakus!
And what now?
Vile creature!
And again! Huh?
Huh?
What's up?
Vile creature!
I've been too much for you, was I?
Excellent yes. Choice!
Yeah! Don't take it personally.
And what now?
Oink, oink, little piggies!
Disgusting. He won't last long.
Killed.
What's up? Yeah, why not?
Huh?
End it!
And what now?
Ha ha!
Kill!
Take it personally!
He put up a fight!
Vile creature!
Huh?
I'm with you!
Of course not!
Understood.
Yes, yes!
Die?
At your service?
Die?
Of course!
Oh, wait, you understand.
Of course!
Gladly.
Yes,
I understand.
Choice.
The victory over the orcs was hard fought, but you have won, not least thanks to your aides. You take care of the wounded and take your leave before you finally continue on your way into the mountains. The village seems much emptier than on your last visit. Most of the A hard path lies ahead of you, down into the valley, and then up into the snow-covered mountains. It will be difficult, if not impossible, to climb back afterwards. You should be sure that you've made all the necessary preparations before you continue. The old ruins of Wackenstein appear before you.
Henson, do you have a minute?
Have you found Helga?
Henson, I heard you try to steal the bell.
Steal? No, I wanted to borrow it. But I had less luck with that red-haired witch than you.
See you later.
Let me know if you...
Fits like a glove.
Loud and powerful music follows the fog and the figures, crashing over your head in roaring waves. The force of the music clouds your senses, and it seems as if the statue of the blind guardian rises from his throne. You want to draw your companion's attention to it, but then you suddenly realize that you have a tankard of ale in your hand. You instinctively try it, and are happy to note that you haven't drunk such good ale since Ogre's death. The night becomes a colourful whirl of ale, music, dance, and ecstasy. You can no longer remember why you're here or who you're celebrating with. For a few hours, you forget what was and what is to come. You are completely in the here and now. You wake up the next morning. You're lying on your back and staring into a sky that is much too bright. You turn onto your side with difficulty and see your companions all around you, but no one else. The remains of a wild party. Campfires, tents, and ale tankards are still there, but the magic has gone. You stand up, muttering curses, and try to suppress the taste in your mouth and the pain in your head. To your great surprise, you see that the stony figure of the blind guardian has revealed a tunnel that leads into the rock of the mountain.
If we go on now, we probably can't come back. The mechanism looks like it will close the pass behind us. We should be sure that we have done all we need to.
The victory over the orcs was hard fought, but you have won. Not least thanks to your aides. You take care of the wounded and take your leave before you finally continue on your way into the mountains. While you rest under a ledge at noon, Rodario and Fergus decide to go ice fishing, and the dwarves immediately pronounce their opposition.
Ice and water are both treacherous. They entice you to them. Before you know it, you disappear into them forever.
Like in a marriage, you mean? At first, the woman entices you, but if you stay in her arms like a good boy, the good life is over all too quickly.
The good life? In which you go behind the backs of other men, get beaten up, and one day die painfully of a sexually transmitted disease.
All slander, my dear.
Rodario bares his teeth for a moment and then follows Fergus to the shore.
He reminds me of a billy goat we used to have. Mounted everything that got in its way. One day he mounted a goat that was standing too close to a cliff. The two of them fell down the cliff in the best of spirits. Ha 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 ha.
You reach a large frozen lake surrounded by a thick pine forest. The quickest way would be to walk straight over the ice, but you don't know how stable it is. The detour through the forest would be safer, but would also take much longer. You decide to take the quicker route and walk directly across the frozen lake. The ice carries your weight and you make good progress at first. But after about a third of the way, the ice begins to rumble and some cracks begin to form.
Let me go ahead. I am the lightest and can search for a safe route.
She may be light, but I know all there is to know about ice. There are frozen lakes that we cross up in the Brown Range during winter. Let me go ahead. I don't fancy falling through the ice on account of some long'un.
I can't vouch for Gormgar, but it's true that the lakes in the Brown Range often freeze over in winter. We always played on the ice as children.
Goimgar takes over leading the group with unusual confidence. He warns you about the fragile places in the ice and sends you back more than once when the route taken turns out to be too dangerous. You reach the other side unscathed, and even Boindil nods his recognition to Goimgar.
It was nothing.
A proud grin flits across the face of the otherwise gloomy-looking gem cutter. It snows all day, and the cold wind continues to get stronger. The dwarves trudge stubbornly on, but at some point Fergus can take it no longer.
Oh, we are walking right into the eye of a blizzard.
We have snowstorms in the Brown Range, too. If you get caught in a storm while hunting, you simply wait it out in a snow cave.
The blizzard will be on us before we can build a snow cave. We should look for a sheltered spot and light a fire.
Instead of looking for a shelter, you simply go to some crags nearby and shovel up some snow on the sides to make a windbreak. You feel better almost as soon as you leave the biting wind. Fergus lights an alchemic fire, and the closeness of your companions ensures a reasonably warm night. By the next morning, the blizzard has blown over, and you set off on your way again. Your path leads you over a snowy, hilly plain, and as you scale a particularly steep hill, you falter. A crevasse opens out in front of you. You look around, but there isn't any point nearby where you could cross over the gap. You attach a rope to a huge rock and abseil down, one after the other. The floor of the crevasse is darker and colder than you'd expected. The sun hardly ever reaches down this deep. You light torches and look around. At some distance, you notice the entrance to a cave, which seems to wind upwards on the other side. But you can't be sure that this path leads out. You are afraid that you might get lost in the ice cave and freeze to death in misery. But ultimately, your curiosity is rewarded. You find, after an hour's search, a winding passage that leads you to a large chamber. You walk ahead with your torch outstretched and see a shadow in the ice. You step backwards in shock as you realize that it's the body of a frozen human. Something glittering in the floor grabs Goimgar's attention, an ornamented gold shield. Part of it is frozen into the ice, but it should be easy to free.
Pure gold! This thing must be worth quite a bit, though it would be completely useless in a fight.
You allow Goimgar to free the shield from its icy prison. After you've had a look around the rest of the chamber and taken a short break, you look for a way back up to the surface. You are able to continue on your way without any further delay. You finally arrive at the entrance to a valley that curves its way towards Ironhald, the Firstling stronghold.
Vrakus, we've done it!
Get down!
Up there!
Run! I can't maintain the spell for long!
Put him on Goimgar's shield! To the gate! Quick!
As you approach the first gate, you see guards on the battlements. You call as you run.
By Vrakus, we are dwarves of the kingdoms of the Secondlings and the Fourthlings. Open the gate!
Their leader gives orders that you cannot hear, but moments later, the gate opens up for you.
Report back! Man the walls and the defences!
The guards follow the orders immediately.
Who are you that lead the Alpha to our door?
How dare you speak to us like that? Dwarf who seems to have no name.
Boindil steps forward before you can stop him.
I am Boindil Doubleblade, a child of the smith of Berowyn folk. And that is my brother Boindil, who needs a healer immediately.
The commander pulls down his scarf, and his face leaves you speechless.
Only a dwarf could make such a fuss.
Balander Steelfinger. I protect the main gate of the Firstlings. Therefore, it is my duty to regard all guests precisely before I invite them in.
But you are a woman.
You have a keen eye, Boindil Doubleblade.
The tender features and soft fluff leave no room for doubt. A female dwarf is the commander of the guard. She gives orders for the injured Boindil to be taken care of. Four dwarves pick him up on his shield, and Boindil follows them.
Stay with your brother. I will bring the rest of you to Queen Xamtis, where you can explain what you're doing here. Come closer, and be welcome to the Kingdom of the Firstlings.
I am Tungdil Goldhand of the Fourthling Kingdom.
You introduce your companions one by one, not forgetting to mention the twins and the Maegar too. You then explain the reason for your visit. You report on the advance of the Perish Land, the death of the Magi, and the dispute about the next High King. The dark brown eyes of the Queen fix on you for a moment before she speaks.
What you report sounds very serious, Tungdil. You can be sure of the support of the Firstlings. How may we assist you?
There is only one way to defeat Nodon. Keenfire. To forge it, we need the best smith your kingdom has to offer. Help us, and thus help your kingdom, my queen.
The queen considers, then nods.
So be it. Could there ever be a better time to revive the old commonality of the kingdoms? Balandis here is not only my best warrior, she is also my best smith. She will accompany you.
Your eyes fall upon Balandis, and you notice the blood rushing to your cheeks.
I will do my best. You can trust in my axe and my hammer.
We must continue on our journey to the Fifthlings in the Grey Range.
Then I will show you the entrance to the tunnels. You will be in the Perish Land within a few orbits.
You know the tunnels, but still the Firstlings live in seclusion.
Our isolation was self-imposed. My mother knew that the other kingdoms would not simply accept her as the queen. She wanted to give them time to get used to it.
Your Highness, in the name of the Council of the Kingdoms, I request that you send a delegation to the Blue Range to take part in the discussions. We all have a common enemy.
There has never been any enmity between my kingdom and the others. It was more neglected friendship and habit that has made us strangers to one another. As soon as you set off for the Grey Range, we will head east to see our brothers and sisters again. I will have rooms prepared for you and your companions so that you can rest. It has been some time since we have had guests, but we still know what hospitality means. Come to me when you are ready to depart.
You guess that this water powers all the machines in the underground city, a masterpiece of engineering.
Uh,
Hello.
What is it, Tundo?
It would seem that a lot of important positions are occupied by female dwarves in the Firstling Kingdom.
Is it not common where you come from that men and women share the duties?
Of course. Among the humans and the Secondlings, the women help out in the house so that the men have time for their duties. That's how it is written in the books, too.
Here, posts are assigned according to the skills of the applicant, not gender. It's only natural that the most important posts are occupied by women.
She winks at you and gives you a knowing glance, although the whole thing still befuddles you.
What is it like living with the Firstlings? I haven't seen much yet, but many things seem to be different to life with the Secondlings in Ogre's Death.
I can't make any real comparisons either. I grew up here and have never left our kingdom. I can hardly wait to see the halls of the Fifthlings. They were the best smiths before we took on the mantle.
Don't expect too much. Their halls have been in the hands of the enemy for over 1,000 cycles.
I read that the orcs avoid the stronghold, as if there were a curse on it.
Even reading doesn't seem to be frowned upon among the Firstlings. You feel at home here. But that isn't only down to the books.
See you later.
The second dwarf stronghold you have ever seen also impresses you greatly. The Firstling stronghold is very different to Ogre's Death, but you'd rather not say which you prefer. The inventiveness of your people still impresses you, and fills you with pride for being a dwarf. Geralda looks depressed.
You look like something's bothering you.
It's just... they avoid me. You're the only one who talks to me.
Yeah, well, you did try to kill us when we first met you.
Geralda gives a wry smile.
Not exactly the best of first impressions, right?
You're not a bad person, Geralda. Just give them some time. You said you wanted to join the Free Folk. What do you know about them?
To be honest, I don't know very much at all. It is said they are like a kingdom, just without a kingdom. No clans, no obligations and traditions, no repressive expectations, just dwarves living together.
And where do I find them?
Everywhere and nowhere. They hide. I think I almost found one of their cities. I don't know anymore.
See you later.
It is simply legendary. No, it is mythical. We definitely need a large theater so we can convey the impression of this grandeur to the spectators.
It's going to be difficult, but we'll manage it. But it will be more expensive.
It would appear you like it here.
Like it? It is fabulous. I almost feel like giving up. Not even the best of illusions could possibly imitate this. But say, what brings you to us, Tangdil?
And how is your new play coming along?
Good, very good. The band of adventurers who set off to defeat Nodon, aided by the Queen of the Dwarves from the Kingdom of the Firstlings. It's going to be a real challenge to present this story in all its greatness.
Do you already have a title?
I haven't decided for sure yet, but at the moment I'm thinking along the lines of the heroic dwarves and their loyal companions who opposed Nodon despite all the challenges to destroy him and save Girdlegard.
I must go. Rest now.
Rest? Haven't you seen? There are machines that keep the whole city alive. I must take a look.
Ah, Tungdil, I was wondering when you would pay me a visit.
I thank you and Jeroen. You appeared at the right moment. May I, ask why?
It was down to you. Your speech about the responsibility I owe to my realm. Lot Yonam was a good teacher.
Her face darkens when she thinks of her old companion.
There are 100 reasons that Nodon deserves to die. That is why I went back to the Secondlings and took another look through the books. I discovered a passage that said Keenfire can only take its effect against evil when it is wielded by a foe of the Undergrounders.
A foe of the Undergrounders? It's going to be difficult to persuade Nork to help us.
I didn't mean to eavesdrop, but I think I might have an answer to the problem. The Alpha are also your foes, aren't they?
What the...
Half-human? Half-elf. My mother bequeathed me her gifts and her weapons. I got very little from my father, but his eyes are an advantage.
We should keep your parentage secret, especially from Geralda.
I'm in no doubt that the Alphar did terrible things to her, and I'm not keen on letting her kill me.
If what Nomura told me earlier is true, this Geralda could be just as great a danger as Nodon. She could take control of generals or kings, maybe even me.
You are aware of the danger, but you don't have the energy to think about it right now. You push the problem aside.
Then that's agreed. We will keep Nomura secret to ourselves. And you're sure that only a foe of the Undergrounders can use Keenfire?
Anyone can use it like a normal axe. But only a foe of the Undergrounders can command its magical powers. I don't know much about her, but a half-elf should pass as a foe of all dwarves.
All right then. You will wield Keenfire in the battle against Nodon. But we're going to have to make it first.
You said it. The actress takes her leave with a little nod.
How are things with Jeroen? Could you help him?
He's doing well. He should be back to full strength after some rest.
You still don't know what kind of being is hidden under the armor. But the Maegar's powers seem to have done a good job.
The Firstlings have offered to improve his armor. And when one of the best smiths in Girdlegard offers something like that, you should definitely take them up on it.
How are you and your powers? You look a little exhausted.
I won't lie to you. It has already been too long since I was in a place where I can draw new strength. My power is trickling away like water from a leaky pipe.
Is that perhaps a way to weaken Nodon?
No, I wouldn't count on that. Even if we could keep him away from the magical realms, the being that lives within him has given him unknown powers.
How was Syntharas able to overcome your shield? Can Alphar use magic?
No, certainly not. I don't know much about their people, but I think they have innate powers. Conjuring darkness, extinguishing fire, changing dreams. Little things that fill humans with fear and ensure the potency of terrifying legends about their people. Syntharas used a trick, not a spell. We killed two Alphar near Sovereignstone. They had crystals on them which they had received from Nod On to protect them from the spells of the Magi. He must have used a stone like that.
Take some rest. And I hope you'll still be here at dawn.
The Magir gives you a reproachful look. Don't worry. We'll stand by you until this expedition has reached its destination.
It feels good having the Magir and her companion at your side again.
Namora, may I speak with you? I was wondering how you ended up being an actress with Rodario and Fergus.
I have seen many places and done many things that I would like to forget. For a long time, I didn't know what to do with my life. But then I met Fergus. There are no secrets between us. I have never had to pretend with him. He introduced me to Rodario, and I feared the worst, but he was delighted. He immediately wrote me into a new play.
That sounds like Rodario. Your parents, relationships between humans and Alphar is uncommon.
My mother brought me up on her own. I don't know what happened to my father.
You look at her compassionately. Namora notices your expression and shrugs her shoulders.
I never knew him, so I don't miss him.
You don't believe her. You never got to know your parents either. But you still miss them even though Lot Yonan raised you.
This might be a strange question, but do you sometimes wish...
that I wasn't half-elf? Of course I've thought about it. But what's the point? This is how I was born, how I am, and it's something I can't change. And while perhaps it might now serve some benefit for the first time, my heritage could be the key to saving Girdlegard.
See you later.
Tungdil.
How is he?
He's lost a hell of a lot of blood.
The crazy glint in Boindil's eyes has given way to serious concern.
I'm doing fine. You must rest, brother. Stay on your back so the wounds can heal. Fortunately, he hasn't lost his pig-headedness. As long as he has that, he'll come through.
Boindil forces a grin, but you can imagine what he's really thinking and feeling.
I thought Antakai was going to look after him. Didn't her magic help?
We don't want her help. Magic is no use. And we certainly don't want anything to do with Summerson.
You know there is no point arguing with the twins about magic. There is too much of a fine line between conviction and stubbornness. Boendal would rather die than be healed by the Maegar.
We'll have to go on without him. He won't manage more than 100 paces without dropping down dead the state he's in.
No! I'll manage, Scholar. Just give me 2 orbits, then I'll be fine. It's just a scratch.
Boendal tries to stand up, but he doesn't have the strength. You shake your head.
Stay here and recover, Boendal. We'll meet you again in time for the big battle against Nodon. You have done your bit.
But where one of us is, the other is too. It is the greatest deed that has ever been carried out by our people. Oh. It would seem you are right, Scholar.
We'll be separated for the first time in our lives. I will miss you by my side in battle. The first 100 runts will be for you.
You will have to protect him and the others on your own now, brother. Don't take on too much and rein in your frenzy. You must control your anger better than you usually do. Promise me.
I promise.
Tears run down the bearded cheeks of the 2 twins. They have never had to part like this before.
I shouldn't bother Boendal anymore. He needs peace and quiet to recover.
I've gathered all of the metal we need for Keenfire. I'm ready to depart.
You nod and then look her solemnly in the eyes.
Once we set off, stay in the background, keep out of fights, and avoid all danger.
The female dwarf's expression darkens.
Shall we engage in a trial fight, Mr. Dwarf?
No, no, Bivrakus. No, I know that female dwarves can fight. It's because of the axe. You're the only one who can forge it. If something happens to you, we won't be able to stop Nodon.
The face of the smith relaxes, and then a smile appears on her lips.
I can look after myself.
Greetings, Queen Xamtis.
The Queen bows her head slightly, prompting you to speak.
Please excuse me for asking, Your Highness, but how is it that a queen is sitting on the Firstling throne?
The Queen smiles. She has clearly been expecting the question.
It began with an argument. My father valued my mother's advice, but disputed her ability to lead the kingdom. This frustrated her, and she demanded the chance to prove the contrary. In the end, they agreed that my mother would govern the Firstlings for 14 orbits. And during this time, there was an attack by trolls, and my mother put them to flight with cunning and bravery. When my father demanded the throne again, she defied him, and the clans followed her. The other kingdoms were appalled and refused to receive my mother, but our kingdom saw that she was a good queen. And when she died 230 cycles ago, the people demanded that I should follow her onto the throne.
Your Highness, with your permission, I will take my leave to prepare for the journey.
Of course. Let me know when you are ready.
The The walls are all covered with gold leaf, reflecting the warm light of the candles and chandeliers. You have never seen a room like it before. You couldn't even have imagined something like this. The royal guards are dressed in magnificent armor. Not only can they fight effectively in it, they also don't look out of place in the throne room. The throne appears to be forged of pure steel. You involuntarily search for impurities or defects, but the smithery is impeccable. You have never seen such an open, light, and airy construction. It was obviously built by the hands of a master. The steel is inlaid with gold, silver, fricassium, and all the other valuable metals that the firstlings have dug out of the body of their mountains.
Greetings, Queen Xamtis.
The Queen bows her head slightly, prompting you to speak.
Is everything ready for our journey to the Kingdom of the Fifthlings?
We have provided wagons for you and your companions. Are your preparations complete?
Yes, we are ready.
The Queen nods slowly.
Rally your companions. I will march east with my host, but don't be misled. The fate of the perished land is in your hands, not mine. May you succeed and return unhurt. Vrakas be with you.
The plains of Tabayin are the most fertile in Girdlegard, and rightly give the kingdom its nickname of the breadbasket. The east of the land has been in revolt since the perished land advanced, and the peace seems to have broken in the heartland too, as a group of strangers crawl out of a hole in the ground.
Why don't we just look for a tunnel that hasn't collapsed?
And what if we don't find one? If we're overground, we at least know that there's a way, even if it's dangerous. Let's go.